Greetings and welcome to the Mount Rushmore podcast. My name is Jeff, and I'm joined, as always, by these two good-looking guys, Richard.
Hello.
And Michael.
Howdy. He couldn't get through it.
No, he tried to do without
That's a good look. And then it, like, the laughs and the smile came, and he's like,
oh, these wonderful, you have great personalities. These guys have great personalities. And I've been proud to be a podcaster with them since the inception of audio, recorded audio. We've been doing it since.
That's true.
Yeah.
It's a fact. When we used to put it on the wax cylinder.
Put it on wax, as Adam Yauch. Yeah. I don't know which boy who was Beastie said that. But well, speaking of Beastie Boys or Beastie Persons or musical persons, this time around in the podcast, we're talking about American bands, the Mount Rushmore of American rock bands, to be specific. Richard, you chose it, right?
I did. And I started thinking about, it was just one of those ones where I started thinking about, my first thought was just rock bands. And then I realized, okay, three of the options are going to be the three options that everyone has all the time at the top three. And they're all British bands. Okay, yeah. Beatles, Rolling Stones, The Who. You've got room for one more band, basically.
Yeah.
Then I started thinking about, well, what if we narrowed it down a little bit and removed all the British rock bands? Because for whatever reason, there's a ton of great British rock bands, even though they're this tiny island. Mm-hmm. You know, the sun never sets on the British rock empire, I guess. So I started thinking about American rock bands. And I think that kind of brought up some interesting choices that you have to make. And what are the reasons why you're choosing them? Because it's not, maybe the bands aren't as iconic with a big I as Beatles, Rolling Stones, bands like that. Mm-hmm. But I think you've still got some very interesting choices there, and you kind of have to decide for yourself what constitutes a rock band versus just a band. That's another aspect of it too. So I thought there are a lot of different ways we could go with this.
Cool. I think there's a lot, there's an onus on being from the place where it's from. Not that the Beatles or Stones didn't have to be incredible, and not that they weren't, but they weren't from the factory where it's all made. And I can see how that would be just a different parameter. You always have to kind of go along with that or go against that, and it forms your sensibility. Or at least it did probably in the early days of the genre. But all right, Richard chose it, so Michael gets to go first.
Okie dokie. My first band that I chose was the Beach Boys. And I think I chose them because they had, like kind of Richard alluded to, they had so much influence on how music was made, like going forward. I think that what the Beatles were for like a British sound, the Beach Boys kind of became like this kind of totem for what America kind of sounded like, at least for a short period of time. I think that you think of them and you think of them as very, very American and very Southern California and very something that is so different than the rest of the world has. I think just that, you know, they sung about cars and girls and surfing and whatever at first. And then you get into, they started realizing, or Brian Wilson started expanding what the music could be. They started expanding on what the themes were of what he was writing about. And, you know, he goes and puts out Pet Sounds, and that starts to influence the Beatles to a degree. And then he gets mired down with, you know, trying to write Smile. And that becomes this big kind of thing that lingers over him for, you know, over the band and over music for, what, 30 years or whatever. And I think that they are just, they kind of occupy this very iconic state. And I think sometimes when we talk about Mount Rushmore, we talk about not only something that is influential, but also iconic. And when you think of America or Americana or an idea of America, I think that they are kind of right in there as like an answer to what the Beatles were in a sense, but sounded totally different. I mean, it's not like this, it's not like anything sounded like, their music didn't sound like rock and roll from 6 years before that, really. And their music really didn't sound like anything British either. It was very unique, I thought, to their kind of time and place.
Yeah, that's a cool pick.
I didn't have them on my list because this was the one specifically where I was like, rock band or just great pop band. And I'm not sure where I feel they fit into the spectrum of rock bands. Because, you know, when I think of the Beach Boys, I think of great pop songs. I don't necessarily think of them. I mean, they started out at least with kind of the rock instrumentation and that sort of feel to them, but they pretty quickly progressed away from that. And if you think about something like Pet Sounds, that's Baroque pop. That's not rock and roll necessarily.
Well, then I guess
that's why I didn't have them on my list, even though I completely agree with everything you said about how influential they are and kind of the, you know, the boundaries that they pushed. You know, I mean, they put out Pet Sounds, and that pushed Paul McCartney to want to make Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. You know, the friendly competition there, kind of pushing each other to see what they could do in the sphere of kind of pop music. So yeah, I would agree with everything you said, but I just don't know that they're a rock band.
I would definitely label them as rock because of their rock origins, and their touring show was always rock and roll based. Like their touring show was always, they could seldom accomplish the intricate. I mean, they could pull off intricate harmonies, but I would definitely say if their inspiration was Chuck Berry meets the Four Freshmen, then I think they have just a foundation in rock and roll. But like you said, their journey took them into very innovative places in the studio and stuff like that. So
I think that's a very interesting, well, you know, I didn't. So are there any bands that kind of stayed basically, there must be a lot that have stayed making the exact same thing over and over to a degree.
That began in that era. I would not. So I'd say they either evolved or ended, but something like an AC/DC that started it, you know, 20 years later.
There you go. Okay.
They always stayed fundamentally the same. On one album.
I think that's pretty interesting. Then that idea of a band that was kind of nascent within the rock and roll genre and then kind of evolved early. They were in their early, you know, they had their feet in the door early on, versus a band who had decided this is what we want to sound like, and this is our sound.
Yeah.
Because they've had 20 years or 30 years or however many years of rock and roll and the whole, you know, all of that going forward. Mm-hmm. I got to think about
that. What I think is also interesting for me when the Beach Boys are analyzed, there was a interesting discussion about this kind of analog analysis of the Beach Boys, and which Richard's evaluation kind of is one side of that is the, when the scene between rock started or evolved, it went between New York, the East Coast, West Coast, and on the West Coast was basically LA. And then in the late 60s, San Francisco started to be a real big scene, and the real trippy progressive stuff was happening in San Francisco, which if you talk to somebody in San Francisco about the Beach Boys, they were just a candy pop rock kind of doofus act. And they were always embarrassed later on in their career to be evaluated as this kind of bubblegum pop kind of group or sunshine pop. And so I see what you're talking about, Richard, there. But it's interesting to me how rock and roll started to fragment into a critic's, since Rolling Stone was in San Francisco, there were those critical darlings of rock that existed in the West Coast. It'd be like a Grateful Dead and the Dylan and folk rock people. And then there was like the folkies and the rockers from Motown and New York. But it is interesting to me how what is rock is also a really important question too, because they would all probably be all on the rock charts. I don't think there was, I don't know if there was a pop rock chart at that time. So if it was just strictly through Billboard, maybe they would have been on the charts.
It would have just been the Hot 100 or whatever, Hot 100. Top 40. Yeah, so it just would have been Top 40. Yeah.
We'll
so
talk about
that. Blended together.
One thing that I'd learned is until the British Invasion, persons like our acts, Motown acts, groups like Sam and Dave or Sam Cooke or Otis Redding, they were on the rock chart. They had gone off the race chart into the rock chart. And then when the British invasion came, there were so many new white acts that the chart went back to being the rock. Those acts all went back onto the R&B chart. So those acts did, which is, I think, fascinating because what is rock was even evaluated based on the color of the performer's skin. So, yeah. So that's an interesting thing, too. The amount of pop that is in your rock is makes one evaluate. Yeah. Right. What is it? All right, Richard, what do you got?
All right. So I'll give you a band. We were talking about bands whose sound didn't really evolve throughout their career. And East Coast versus West Coast. I'll go with an East Coast band. The Ramones.
Oh, sweet.
Also on my list. My second choice.
The Ramones are a t-shirt you can get at Hot Topic. That's not really a band.
Good point. No, it's actually, they're actually called Ramens.
Ramens?
And then there's a big bowl of noodles where the eagle with the guitars should be.
Oh, okay.
No. Look, incredibly influential, you know, basically, you know, I don't want to say started punk, but in terms of popular culture, they're probably the first band that that people, you know, back in the 70s were able to associate with punk rock and have breakthrough somewhat into the public consciousness. You know, they go in 1976 over to England to play a bunch of shows, and that's where Johnny Rotten learns about punk rock, and that's where Joe Strummer and Mick Jones go and see the show and get inspired to go start making more punk rock instead of, you know, Joe Strummer was in like a pub rock band basically before that. Just this incredible mixture of kind of 60s bubblegum pop and, you know, early rock and roll, but mixed with these really darkly funny lyrics and just incredibly unique. And I think really paved the way for so many other bands. I mean, they're just helping to launch the whole CBGB scene. It's hard to overstate their influence on modern rock music and modern popular culture. Like you said, there's still kids who are, you know, weren't born when Joey Ramone died, who are wearing Ramones t-shirts. I don't know that they know more than a couple of Ramones songs, but they know the band because the band has managed to live on, you know, well beyond, you know, what you would think a band that never made it even a dent in the pop charts would be able to have a legacy of. They were able to accomplish that.
Yeah. Do you think they innovated much? Like the thing of like the aesthetic they created, the attitude that they had seemed to synthesize what they liked about rock and roll.
I think they thought was
bullshit about rock and roll.
I think they really pioneered finishing a set within 17 minutes.
Yes.
I mean, playing 10 songs to completion as fast as you could and being off the stage, you can go drink some more beers. Yeah. I think no band has done it better.
Yeah. Well, rock and roll has always been a rebellion against authority, parents. Ramones were rebelling against rock and roll, all the bullshit that they'd seen happen.
Yeah, they were rebelling against like the, you know, prog rock and, you know, Eagles and Steely Dan and that kind of, you know, if you want to call it bloated excess of rock music in the 1970s. You know, it was, these songs are 2 minutes long. They've got great melodies. Get in, hit you hard, get out, bam, move on to the next song.
Yeah.
So I don't know that they innovated so much as they expertly synthesized a lot of what, like you said, was they considered to be great about rock and roll and what rock and roll they thought should be.
Yeah, the question I think is within a certain era, when you think of the argument about Mike Love, hero or villain, is every rock and roll's, is every artist's job to innovate and to break new ground, or are they also entertainers whose job is just kind of go out and do that thing that people enjoy and please an audience? And I think Mike Love was the latter. He wasn't a musical genius. And at the beginning of the rock era, nobody was. And it wasn't even part of the job description. Like, rock musicians weren't known, couldn't go sit in with the jazz trio. They weren't that good of a musician. They were building on forms that had already existed in R&B and other things. So the idea that you would say, did the Ramones, were they musical innovators? No, other than the tempo that they established and were able to maintain. It wasn't part of the job. The attitude was the part of the job. And that's what rock has always been built on, is that attitude. So
there's a good, there was a good picture of the Ramones right there holding their... holding the classic surfboard.
Oh, wait, their surfboard.
There you go.
Yeah. And suffering for their art. If you think of like the mansion that Brian Wilson lived in that kept him separate from the world, you know, the Ramones were always plugging around in that van, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Talk about just the iconic nature of how they dress too. We're looking at these pictures that Jeff has pulled up if you're watching it, like the YouTube feed. And you know, they're out there in basically a uniform, the same way the Beatles used to dress, all the four of them the same thing, the way the Beach Boys would dress similarly when they were on stage. But they really like took whatever was like they established, kind of this punk aesthetic, or at least helped make it more mainstream, definitely. And make looking like, you know, like a cheap dirtbag cool. I mean, we've come so far from being so clean cut and, wearing nice suits on stage to wearing shitty t-shirts and leather jackets and hair is covering most of our face.
Yeah. It's funny. I was realizing that the image of the group with Brian Wilson and is the Pendletones, which was their name before the Beach Boys, because they all wore the matching Pendleton shirts. So in a way, that rock uniform was kind of something that they were establishing. The guy on the right, David Marks, I think, like one of their first guitarists, who not Richard Marks. Murray Wilson tried to sleep with his mom and was not successful. So he wanted him to get kicked out of the band. Okay. So, Michael, what's your second one?
That was, Ramones was also my second choice.
Oh, sorry. Okay. Cool. Okay. Then, Michael, what's your third?
No, my second.
How do we do this? Okay. Richard, your second. There you go. Sorry.
There, we'll get there.
Okay.
My second choice, the American Beatles.
Cheap trick.
Yep. I mean, how could you forget? Can you honestly tell me you forgot, Jeff? Forgot the magnetism of Robin Zimmer or the charisma of Rick Nielsen?
I want you to want me.
Exactly.
I just watched that movie the other day.
That's so good.
Oh my God. That movie is so perfect. Fast Times. Just, he's so good. Mike Damone is so good. He's such a scumbag.
Yeah, he's perfect as a scumbag.
Rockford's finest.
Yeah, Rockford, Illinois' finest band. You know, started off as a kind of just this workaday bar band that found a way to go to Japan and make it big and somehow parlay that into a 40-year rock and roll Hall of Fame career. They were, to me, I mean, the American Beatles thing obviously was something that the Japanese press kind of coined and went with. But it's earned to some extent, I think, because their sense of melody is pretty unmatched in terms of major rock bands, just from a musical standpoint. I mean, the way they were able to fuse kind of glam rock and hard rock with these Beatles sensibilities and sense of melody was something that no other bands were really doing back in the 70s. And I think you can, you know, there's a reason why every bands all the way from like the glam rock bands of the 80s to Smashing Pumpkins, you know, so many bands have listed Cheap Trick as one of their major influences.
Yeah.
And the fact that they've been doing it for this long and Rick Nielsen hasn't run out of guitar picks yet, it's just an amazing accomplishment how many he's thrown into the crowds over the years. No, just the fact that they've – listen, I listened to the last Cheap Trick record that came out a year or two ago. It's fantastic. So many of these bands have turned into legacy bands where they just have no interest in putting out new music, or if they do, it's just kind of like this throwaway, kind of sounds exactly like the last album that they put out. And Cheap Trick are still pushing themselves. They're still making great music. Even now, 40 years from when they started, when they there's absolutely no need for them to do that. I mean, they're still touring 200 days a year, and you know, and everything from major stadiums to county fairs. They're just fascinating to me that they're just sort of, I think when the nuclear war happens, there will be, you know, cockroaches, Twinkies, and Cheap Trick playing a county fair somewhere.
I think they were like, I remember Kiss, there's in Surrender, they've got My Kiss Records on. My Kiss Records out. And I remember Gene Simmons was talking about, we love Cheap Trick. They're the only guys that we love touring with. If we feel like they could put on as big a show as we did, and they put on as graphic, like Cheap Trick always had a very grab with the Courier font, like an old typewriter font. They always had a very graphic presentation. They always packaged their rock in a really cool visual way that looked great on an LP.
Yeah. And, I mean, you had the heartthrobs in front with Rick, with Robin Zander and Tom Peterson.
Yeah.
And then you had the dorks in the back with Rick Nielsen and Bunny Carlos.
Yeah. Stick John Wayne Gacy in the behind the drums there. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, basically looking like an accountant behind the drums. I love the thing that they would do where he would at some point during the show break out these like 5 foot long guitar or drumsticks and start using them to play a solo. Just little things like that. And Rick Nielsen basically being a Bowery boy. I mean, he kind of manufactured his stage presence off of Hunts Hall.
Yeah.
Which is kind of an obscure thing to be if you want to be a rock star, but somehow it all works out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of fun. There was the one dude that was kind of way ahead of our time in school, who was the guy who always had the concert tickets. He was kind of the Mike Damone of Shawnee Mission East. He was a huge Cheap Trick fan, and he just kind of was tapped into what they had to offer when everybody else was kind of listening to other dumb stuff. So that's awesome. Yeah, I love that. You know what's funny about rock and roll is think of like how many songs Springsteen has about, you know, glory days or aging out of being a kid but still knowing that or you know, Seeger saying rock and roll never forgets, you know, a song like Surrender saying mommy's all right, daddy's all right, that just seem a little bit weird.
You know? Yeah,
the idea that, you know, hey man, it's okay to grow old. You know, just don't give away your dreams. Don't give away the rock. You know, you can be an old fart and still having fun. It seems like they're living that life. You know, they're still doing it, you know, even though they're a little bit weird. So,
and a little bit old.
And then I think Rick is selling all his guitars at every stop, every tour.
Yeah.
You can come backstage before the show and buy his guitars.
He's got like 500 of them. Yeah. So I don't think he's going to miss a couple here and there.
Yeah, like any one neck guitars. One neck guitars. They're all
five neck guitars. Got those spades.
Yeah. Okay, so this is our halftime, and this is if it was a Super Bowl, this is when a big rock show would happen, right? I mean, it would be something amazing.
Like Rihanna.
I'm Snoopy. Snoopy celebrates America.
Oh man, I was looking at Super Bowl halftime shows from the 70s, and it was like Up With People. It was like a
tribute to Magic,
Mitch Miller,
Blackstone Jr.
yeah, Elvis Presto. But like then it's just like Woody Herman, the Woody Herman Quintet, like jazz. The jazz was playing at the Super Bowl. Oh wow. Download, rate, and review past episodes, and we have a lot of them. And But we would love if you had a suggestion for a future episode, just to contact us through one of our many socials, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Truth Social. Are we still on that? Periscope, Vine, Foursquare, MySpace.
Hit up our MySpace. Yes.
We're on all. Come on, hit us on Classmates. We are on all deleted apps only.
Adobe Instant Messenger. We are only on these things.
You can reach us through Amazon's rate and review function. If you if you happen to download our podcast, just rate and review. Did you like this? We'll send 7 follow-up emails as well that you'll all ignore. I love it when they give you the option. Do you like this or love it? Or do you love this thing or don't like it? And it's like, well, I don't love this thing. So I'm going to press like, I don't like it. And they're like, why don't you love it? It's like, well, don't give me that option. How about that? How about don't go so hard on me, Amazon, for like this pot holder. It's just a fucking pot holder.
Got a note that we get passed. I never got these notes passed, but I knew of them that we get passed. Do you like me? Yes or no? It's like, I don't know. Who are you? I don't know. You sit behind me.
Hey, Richard, I want to bring something up real quick. You mentioned Cheap Trick's 5-foot-long drumstick deal. Have you been noticing? Sorry to turn this into a sports podcast for a second. Have you been noticing or watching any games in and around Dodger Stadium over the last year or so? I've noticed it in the last like few months. People are showing up to Dodgers games with gigantic gloves.
Oh yeah, we went to a game earlier this year, yeah, there were multiple Michael Winfield-sized giant gloves.
Thank you for branding it the proper way. Jeff, back in the day, I wanted to try to sew together and build a gigantic baseball glove that would be the size to catch a kickball. I never got around to doing it, but it was just one of my harebrained ideas. And so I see these giant baseball mitts in the stadium, and I think, God damn it, another one. Another one lost.
What does that make it easier to catch a ball? Is that what?
No, of course not. Would, no. Right?
No.
No way.
You end up break your wrist. You end up obscuring your, or things like it would catch and then flap the person behind brutally. Yeah. It's like trying to catch something with a pillowcase, right? Wouldn't it be tough?
No, Richard, we should have done pillowcases.
Michael, what's your third one?
My third choice. Thank you. Thank you for bringing it back around. All right. Sure. At a halftime. Sure. We're into the first encore, right? If you're lucky.
Yeah.
First encore. My third choice is REM. And I don't know. We're talking about. Go ahead.
All right. Smash Mouth. Okay. Sorry. I got a backspace.
I don't know. Like, I've been trying to think of when we were coming up with like this list, I was trying to think of things that were like influential the same way that like the Ramones were influential, the same way that the Beach Boys were quasi influential. But I think REM has kind of exists in the same sort of space where they're these kind of alt rock, you know, pre indie rock. It's definitely still rock and roll, but with all these other influences because of everything that's come before. But really went on to really influence like the kind of the huge alternative scene of like the late 80s, early 90s, I think, in a way that I don't know if bands like I'm just trying to think of it. I don't think that there are bands that would have dominated so much in like the MTV late 80s, early 90s era, and even into the 2000s without these guys from Atlanta, Georgia, just putting on a masterclass of innovation and putting out different music and having gigantic hits as well. That I don't know. I think they are so unique within rock and roll that they. I think we can't talk about whatever rock became in the 90s without what they were putting down in the early 80s, whether, you know, bands like Pavement came out or even kind of even more like weird, like comedy stuff, like kind of like They Might Be Giants and things. Mm-hmm. Like, I think that there is an influence there with REM that is so deep. And even like their later albums, like New Adventures in Hi-Fi and what was their last one? Yeah, I mean, those were all, they were just like really solid rock albums. And I think it's really interesting that Michael Stipe, after they broke up in like 2011, he was so dominant for so long, or so influential for so long, that has kind of faded off so much. Like, he's not one of these guys that has clinged on trying to relive like a past glory. He's like, he's all written out. I mean, I think he's doing like photography and painting and contributing music, but very under the radar sort of thing. I don't know. You don't see that often with rock and roll stars as big as he was.
Yeah. REM, the weirdest band ever to become one of the biggest bands in the world.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
You know, like, it's the fact that at one point they were, you know, on MTV every 20 minutes, and you couldn't swing a dead cat without hitting one of their videos, is really just remarkable, because they were uncool. They're from this, you know, Athens, Georgia, this place. The only other band that people in the mainstream knew about was an even weirder band, the B-52s. and yet somehow they became, like I said, able to sell out stadiums. And I think it's a testament to just the quality of the music and the, you know, you want to talk about being on a heater. That kind of run that they had with Green, Automatic, and then Time Out of Mind and Automatic for the People. That's a 3-album stretch that I would put up against pretty much any band's 3-album stretch anywhere.
I would even go to extend it to Monster that came out a few years after, where
sure,
that sounded so wildly different than what they were doing a couple years before. This really kind of, it was so much heavier, sonically so different. It was a lot fuzzier sort of sound that was like, but it was very distinctively like REM still. It was so weird and different, and they just kind of changed what they did. And I think, you know, we've been talking a lot about how bands have like evolved. And I think this is definitely a band that had the wherewithal to start out as one thing and evolve into something else, but still sound like REM all the way through.
Yeah, I totally agree. It does feel like it's ice. When you talk about progenitors, I think you see, I don't see Kurt Cobain, I don't see grunge happening without that. It just seemed like
same thing with like the Ramones too. Like, I don't think any of that comes out without both of those bands specifically. Yeah.
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 This seems like
I was going to say, my third choice is a band that Nirvana specifically would reference as a key sort of building block for them. And this is my kind of indie rock choice, and it's the Pixies.
Oh, okay.
You know, a band that sort of innovated the kind of sonic change, the kind of loud, quiet, loud sort of, you know, mindset. And even to this day, I know they're the old, neither of us have Velvet Underground on our list, but there's that saying that Velvet Underground sold, what, 25,000 copies, and every person who bought a copy of it started a band. Mm-hmm. I feel like the Pixies are kind of the modern version of that, except they sold more albums. And because I listen to modern rock music today on Sirius XMU or something like that. And there are times where bands come on and I think, is that a Pixies song that I just don't know? Mm. No, it's a current song. And so much of the kind of sonic adventures that Black Francis and the rest of them kind of took you through are relevant to what bands are making today.
I wish I was more knowledgeable.
I think the Pixies are one that is a band that I recognize as good, but I just haven't put in the hours to listen to it. And I don't know if it's just because it just didn't hit at the right time for me.
Yeah.
But
well, go ahead.
No, that's go ahead.
No, I was gonna say it could be the fact that lyrically, I still don't know what pretty much any Pixie song is about. And I've heard pretty much all of them multiple times, and I've kind of tried to figure it out. I don't know, man. Frank Black's just sort of like singing about stuff that's, you know, maybe religious, but possibly not. Maybe, you know, like Here Comes Your Man, you know, sounds like a kind of probably as straight of a rock song as they've ever done. Turns out it's about an earthquake hitting in a homeless encampment or something like that, or forest fires or something like that. Like, it's all kind of vague when he explains it. So I don't even know that Frank Black knows exactly what most Pixie songs are about, quite frankly. But that's still, you know, they were the case for them I would make is that they were David Bowie's favorite band. Bowie thought they were the most innovative rock band that was going in the 80s and the 90s. Mm-hmm. And if Bowie thinks you're innovative, I think that's a pretty high stamp of approval.
Absolutely. That's funny. If this were a discussion of electronic rock or whatever, Bowie would be somebody who people say like is influenced by a guy like Gary Numan or something like Kraft. They like Kraftwerk and they like Bowie. So he's definitely an influencer. So who's that? Is that Michael? What's your last one?
My last one, and it might seem kind of goofy. I will defend Pearl Jam as their to the last is one of like the last like great American rock bands. I don't know if that have had such a impact kind of socially. I mean, I think there's probably been bands that have you know played bigger shows, but Pearl Jam has become one of these kind of legacy bands that you referred to earlier. Richard, where they are so dedicated to the art of rock and roll and playing rock and roll live and just touring the hell out of the world constantly. Coming up, we're going to go see like The Cure. They have this big tour that's going on and they're another like big, they're this.
No, so's Apollo and Sarah.
Oh, when? Which we're going on Tuesday.
I don't remember. They're going on Tuesday too. Anyway.
Oh, I'll send her a message. But they're this band that plays these like The Cure. Pearl Jam goes out and plays these super long, intense, very varied sets. Eddie Vedder writes a new set list every night. They go out and play something different. They tailor each show, which is just insane. I mean, they have, you know, 30 years of music to put out and refer back to and pull from. And I think as like a touring rock band, I think that there's still no one that feels as big as them. And it kills me that I've never seen them in concert. But just going back to them in general, they came out of obviously this, you were labeled like this grunge sort of band. No one really knows what that was other than some kind of corporate branding sort of thing. And within a few years, they were like, became these people that were like rebelling against. I think they've always been like this kind of post-punk sort of rock band that never really enjoyed being labeled anything that a corporation or MTV or whoever wanted to put on them. And that feels very rock and roll. I mean, to the point that they pulled away from like doing tours with Ticketmaster, that they're just like, nope, we're going to, another thing that kind of made me think about them going to see The Cure, who's had this big battle with Ticketmaster too. But as a band that was like, you were either in like the Pearl Jam side of thing or the Nirvana side of thing in, you know, like 1991 or 92. I don't know. I think that there is just something that has been very enduring about them, even when the music kind of fell off in later years.
Man, I was so anti-grunge. I was so like, it was like, one, I was Seattle, just mad. Boo. I was so mad. I was just mad that like, I don't know, when I was a kid, all we had was torn ass jeans and shitty flannel shirts. And then, right. You know, you had to have an Izod and you had to have khakis and you had to have this and that. And like, I was so mad that all of a sudden everybody got to dress shitty and, you know, not shave, grow up their hair. Like, oh, damn it. I was so mad at that. And be vegetarian? Come on, that's too far. All right, Richard, what's your final choice?
All right, I figured that it was important to have some representation from thrash metal, because I think that's one of the really prime American created music genres in terms of rock. So I had to go with one of the big four thrash metal bands. So of course it's Dave Matthews Band. No,
just kidding. Shit.
It's Metallica. It's okay. Starship. It's Metallica. There you go. Had it? You were typing that in before I even.
I was. It wasn't name. Slayer. I knew it was Metallica.
Wasn't Anthrax? Wasn't Megadeth? It had to be Metallica. No, they were the band that broke through. They're the band that made it big, out of the big four. Were willing to adapt their style to a more mainstream audience while still with like the Black Album, still maintaining the core essence of what made Metallica Metallica. And maybe this just says something about me, but again, they were a band that, to my ears at least, cared more about melody than maybe a lot of their peers. Even though they were playing 200 beats per minute, there was still something melodic happening, and there were tunes that you could really kind of hang your hat on. And again, a really strange choice to become one of the biggest bands in the world. But, you know, you look back to the early to mid, you know, the mid 90s, you know, Metallica's all over MTV and they're all over rock radio and alternative rock radio. And even though they were this, you know, thrash heavy metal band. And I know that they've kind of become a punching bag now because of, you know, some kind of monster. And, you know, that whole documentary that kind of maybe cast them in some, maybe not the most rock and roll light. And maybe some of their most recent albums have been kind of disappointing. And there's the whole collaborating with Lou Reed and creating whatever the hell that was incident. But from what I can tell, they're still ferocious as a live band. And, you know, they've been doing it for 30 plus years and they're still out there, you know, melting faces. That was not an intentional joke about James Hetfield almost getting burned to death on stage, by the way.
Sweet. All right. Great choices, gents. The Mount Rushmore of American rock bands. I think we kind of, it's interesting because when you talk about what is important, which bands are important, you kind of start to kind of have an idea of like what rock is and what it means to people and what it does and what its job is and stuff like that. So cool. So why don't we go with this? Boom, boom. Let's go with this list. Boom. Let's go with Beach Boys. Let's go with Ramones. Let's go with the Cheap Trick and let's go with REM.
All right. I can live with that.
Look at them. I'm sitting right solid. Up on the Mount Rushmore. Okay.
That's a solid four.
Okay. All right.
No Creed, but you know, we had to cut it off somewhere.
No Creed. Sorry, Rob Stapp. Is he still alive? Do you think?
Scott Stapp.
Scott Stapp, yeah.
Yeah, I think he's trying to make another comeback.
Good luck, buddy.
Good for him.
Yeah.
Go for it. Do it.
All right, this is
you can
you can do it. This has been the Mount Rushmore of American Rock. I'm always Jeff.
I'm Richard.
Bye-bye.
Metal Fingers.